Hello, I'm King Link, and it's time to review Outer Worlds, developed by Obsidian Entertainment and published by Private Division. Private Division may be a new company to most of you, it was to me at first, but it's actually Take-Two's Indie Armor Publishing. Outer Worlds can be simply called Fallout, but in space. It's definitely a game similar to Fallout, and that actually might have been the original pitch, Fallout in space. But this time, instead of a single open world, we have multiple planets and even zones on each of those planets, as well as a more futuristic weapon set. At least, that's the idea of the game. I want to thank Brian M. for suggesting that I cover Outer Worlds. So thank you. And if anyone has games that they'd like me to cover, feel free to mention them down in the comments, whether they be new or old. Either way, I'll try to get to them. As always, if you enjoyed the video, consider subscribing and ringing that bell. Now, I do have to have a quick disclosure here. About a year ago, I met with Obsidian Entertainment as part of job hunting and an interview. I did see a bit of this game on site, about 10 minutes, and I didn't end up getting that job, obviously, though I wouldn't have been working on Outer Worlds at all. This was just a couple weeks after they were bought by Microsoft. That interview and the lack of that job, though, have not changed my opinion on the game or the company, but I do want to disclose it here so you can, of course, make the best judgment on this game. On with the review. And to do this game justice, I have to make some references to Fallout, but I'm going to try not to rely on that. Outer Worlds is definitely a different game, and honestly, I think it's a mistake that many people are trying to make this, you know, another binary choice that you have to either like Fallout or Outer Worlds. Listen, Outer Worlds has more than enough binary choices on its own, so let's instead look at Outer Worlds as a singular game, even if we do have to talk about Fallout. Let's talk about the graphics, though. Outer Worlds is certainly interesting looking. There's a lot of vibrant life, beautiful flora, meaning plants, is everywhere in this game, and there's usually some fauna, you know, wildlife gathering around. Granted, I did only see a few hostile creatures in this game, but there is some variety there, and you'll have a lot to see. But Outer Worlds doesn't seem to do much with this look. What are these plants? What is each world really like? Much of the game looks similar. It's a typical outdoor scene with raiders and bandits. You know, perhaps it's too many raiders or bandits for each world to really contain, though. Most maps are actually surrounded by mountains or at least something keeping you in that location. And of course, there are limits to how far you really can travel in any game, but here much of the game feels closed in, forcing you in this area. If you compare this to something like Skyrim, where people could scale, you know, giant mountains, and the game would allow them to, there's no comparison. The levels just feel very cramped here. The one issue I really have with the graphics is there's a lot of similar worlds here. The worlds are definitely colorful, but in hindsight, you know, very few stood out other than the generic alien motif. Many just had generic plants, and even when landing at different areas on a single world, the locations just feel the same. Even when flying to other worlds, again, there's not a huge difference. This might be a bit thematic at points. Part of the game shows that every town location is actually made from pre-builds that are deployed from orbit, landing, and then opening up to be very similar shops. However, this only explains the towns themselves and not the surrounding area or the life on the planet that you can find. There are, however, some unique areas. The big one I enjoyed seeing is a giant ship called Groundbreaker, which should be on screen. It's almost a hub world, but it works well. The locations in the game are a bit smaller than I wanted to see, but there's still exploration. Though it is in that cramped area, you'll pretty much be stumbling over almost every important location as you just walk from point to point as part of missions. Now, since this is sort of a Fallout game, we're going to, of course, have a character creator so you can create your own choice. But I actually found the creator a little lacking. There's not many graphical options to choose from when deciding what your character looks like. I did eventually, while hitting random, find a character that I liked the look of and went with it, but without voice acting, the entire experience feels off. Every other character in the game is fully voice acted, which is absolutely appreciated. But with your character mute, it just feels like characters are just reacting to you rather than in an actual conversation with you. The rest of the characters in the game do look great, but one thing you start to notice as you start having all these dialogue choices is that every character looks directly at the camera in conversations. Now, Fallout 4 was much better about this, and I know these are two different games, with Fallout 4 being Bethesda's third game since Oblivion, which had this issue as well. And I appreciate that, but the conversations here feel like there's something that feels more closer to, like, even Fallout 1 or 2, just with the way they look. This is the same tech that we've had for such a long time, and it really feels dated here. Now, overall graphically, you know, I've had some complaints, but the game is acceptable. It's just not always the most interesting. The fresh worlds you find yourself on at first seem good, but before long it's like the only world you find yourself on, and the game will feel a bit duller. Even when you find a new world, it doesn't have the feeling of exciting discovery, but just kind of a new map at times. With that said though, let's talk story, and this is where I have a serious problem with Outer Worlds. The game starts with you in cryosleep on the ship Hope, with your ship going to Halcyon. Halcyon is the only system entirely owned and operated by corporations, the opening says. Of course, this means we're going to eventually be talking about corporations in the game, and, you know, that can be an interesting topic for video games. Sadly, though, Outer Worlds has only one discussion about corporations. On the first planet, we talk about a corporation that forces people to work to make cans of salt tuna, whatever that is. It's a morality play, though. The corporation is absolutely evil. You know, if you get sick, it's not because germs or you need a doctor. It's because you are weak. You are lazy. You are nothing. The corporation is everything. It's a little much, but some people, of course, will desert this, and the corporation ends up wanting you to divert power from these people. But the thing is, they send you to tell them that they're going to divert power from them, and then suggest that they rejoin the corporation. This is actually only done to give you a chance to side with their side of the story. At the end of the mission, you're going to have to choose between, you know, the kindly old deserters, or the, let's be honest, rather dickish overseer. It's not much of a choice. It's clear where the game wants you to go, but wait, Outer Worlds has a last-minute plea. In a way to kind of twist the story, the game has your companion, Parvati, decide to tell you all about how great the corporation is, and, you know, passionate plea for you. But the thing is, this plea comes way too late, and overall it's just so poorly written, I couldn't accept it. Power to the deserters. Of course, you can make your own choice here, no judgments from me, and you get off-world either way. Then you get to see the next big story, but that's the big problem. No matter which of the next worlds you go to, it's going to have the same story. There's going to be an evil corporation and a plucky, young, idealistic, non-corporation people. Everywhere you go, this is framed the same exact way. You can always make a different choice for each one, siding with the corporation on one and just the normal people on the others. The problem is, though, one side eats babies, figuratively, of course. But, you know, the other is often morally gray, but it becomes a Hitler comparison. One side says Sieg Heil, so it doesn't really matter what the other side says, it's never that bad. But what doesn't really work in all this is that corporations aren't well run. You know, they aren't just profiteering. They aren't malicious because of a bottom line. Instead, they're malicious because they've become caricatures of corporations. They are chaotic evil, but chaotic evil can work as a character, but here, as corporations, they probably should be more lawful evil. Instead, they're just a bunch of, well, assholes, to be honest. This is the evil of Mom Corp from Futurama. You know, it's really funny for a laugh, especially when they do something absolutely absurd, but this isn't a humor show where a nameless company does something outside of the story. This is the core of the story for the majority of this game over at least 10 hours straight. And the thing is, every corporation is like this. There's not an altruistic company or even one fighting against the evil. There aren't even discussions of unions, riots, or anything else. It's just a mindless, bleak dystopia. The thing is, I don't really hate the idea of games being anti-corporation. Just to list some of the games that actually do this type of story well: Final Fantasy VII with Shinra, Resident Evil and the Umbrella Corporation, Fallout with Vault Tech, Bioshock with Andrew Ryan, and even like the ludicrous ones that I just mentioned in my last review of Sunset Overdrive. Most of those games don't focus on this topic, though, as the only thing that they want to say. Here it's the main focus of the story, it's just not done well to be the only thing the game wants to talk about. With all that said, though, the writing in Outer Worlds isn't bad. It's a topic matter that really is a problem. I love it when Outer Worlds can delve into other areas outside of the corporations because there are good moments here. One of my favorites is on screen right now, where it's I'm telling a computer on a ship that I'm not her captain, but the computer is getting me to accept the role as captain. It's clever, it's really smart, I actually like it a lot, because I actually fought against it and the game still made it work. At the same time, the game does become a bit predictable over the course of it. Multiple times in the story you're told to go meet someone, and when you meet almost anyone in the game, you're going to have to do a quest for them because, well, that's how the game goes. Sometimes it's even going to meet someone else as that quest, who then gives you even more quests. Besides, many choices in the game are binary, and you're forced to see both sides before you make that choice. Similar to our first quest, you go to see the man in charge of the town, and then you're told to go talk to the people on the other side. There's not a discovery of the other options or even a natural progression of this, you're just given very clear and well-defined choices. You know, do you want to turn the knob to the right or the left for the people you've already met? At the end of the game, though, you do get the typical Fallout cutscenes ending, but here's the thing, each scene that makes it up, you know, each cutscene is based on a single choice you've made. Did you side with Company A or Group B? It's sad that there's not a deeper or more interesting decision tree here, though. The game does allow you to play against the main story, and I do want to applaud that. The person who wakes you up from your slumber is actually a very wanted man. In most games, that's it. He's just a wanted guy. You can't try to turn him in or anything. But not so in Outer Worlds. You can go and actually try to turn him in and side with the corporations if you want to. But even if you try to do this, well, you're stuck doing those same fetch quests. You literally are telling people you want to turn in a guy who's wanted on, you know, multiple planets, one of the most hated people. But first you have to prove yourself to the corporations, like getting a seal for this guy. He apparently sold it, and like I said, it's an incompetent, chaotic, evil corporation. The thing is, this quest is almost identical to the quest you have to do for the main storyline, which is essentially just get a ton of money. If you continue on that quest, though, you actually produce more fetch quests. Again, instead of handing over to this guy, they keep asking you to do more and more for them. And to go against the main character is to go and side with groups that seem to act as evil as possible. The corporations are just so damn evil in this game, I don't understand why you would ever want to side with them in the first place. And I know that might be part of the game. But the thing is, it's not good writing, because it's not that they're, you know, a little worse than the other side, but they're just made out to be the worst choice ever. So yes, you can choose them if you're absolutely evil. And I think back to Fallout New Vegas, where there's a ton of different factions that you could side with, and what was actually interesting with the writing in that game is every faction had a point. Yes, some of them are definitely worse than others. Siding with Caesar's Legion, for instance, seems really hard to accept, but there's at least a point that some people would make that choice. Here, there's no reason to go with the corporations. Now, I think I've made my issues with the story and writing here clear, so let's move on to the gameplay. But as we do that, I do want to talk about those quests a bit more, because they kind of encompass both the story and the gameplay. Now, many quests in the game are interesting, like our original quest, but what's better is that there's actually a decent amount of ways to talk yourself out of them. You might have to go to a facility and fight your way through enemies, but you can also use your science ability sometimes or your medical knowledge to come up with a better solution. Now, I love when games do this type of thing, especially when these options come up, because it's actually way more interesting than the fight itself can be. And we'll talk about that combat in a bit. But at the same time, many quests are required. Gladys, a black market dealer, wants 10k for a nav key you need. I try to find some way to steal the nav key or talk to her into giving it to me without that, but I couldn't. Later on, there's actually an annoying mission where the player has to go to two different factions to talk to them. Now, this is a major decision in the game, of course, so I won't go too much into this, but you end up having to go and complete two missions per faction so that you can then go back to a main character who can send a message for you to another main character, which completes the next leg, and then you can go to another person, and so on. The point I'm trying to make here, though, is that both quests from both factions, 4 quests total, require the player to do mini combat missions. The ability to talk your way out of quests is quite limited in the game. You're only able to talk your way out of specific quests and at specific times. Otherwise, you have to get involved in the 9 dialogue-based gameplay. When the game does have you talk your way out of quests, it's always skill-based and it's always clear. If you have a high enough dialogue skill or technical skill, you can pass a test and it's stated exactly what you're passing. If you don't, on the other hand, well, you're going to have to do the quest the way Outer Worlds expected you to. I would have loved to see an actual dialogue tree with, you know, endpoints that allows you to talk your way out of these quests without your skills. But that's something most Fallout games lack. It's always a question of if your skill is high enough. Now, for an example of the other option that could happen, you could think of Deus Ex Human Revolution, where you're actually having conversations with people, and if you sway them to your side, sometimes you'd get bonuses, sometimes you'd save a person's life, or sometimes you'd just be able to skip something. It's actually a really well-done system, and I'd love to see it in something like this. So, let's talk about the combat experience, because you're eventually going to have to shoot something, as I've said, or bludgeon them to death, if you will. I played about half the game trying to make the controller work. If you don't know, I tend to use a Steam controller that's mapped to use the 2 control sticks. I couldn't make that seem to work. There's just a feeling that you need a level of precision that the controller never seems to reach. A big reason this is that Outer Worlds doesn't seem to auto-aim that much, and that would have definitely made a better experience for a controller user. Instead, when I switched to mouse and keyboards, I was able to nail almost every shot I wanted. While the game still has a real difficulty to it, I started to wonder about console players. If you're on console and can only use a controller, I honestly think the experience is going to be quite a bit worse than on PC. You still do have the VAT system. This time it's called time dilation, and time moves a little bit faster while you're in it, but it becomes a requirement on the controller systems when it's optional on mouse and keyboard, and that seems wrong. Some simple levels of aim assist here would definitely have been appreciated for controller users, that's all I'm saying. I did struggle quite a bit with the combat, but the more I read online, the more I started to realize how varied your experience with this game is based on your skill loadout. I ended up going heavier with the dialogue-based skills because I find those more interesting, but they're not really great for combat. There are a ton of skills here, and what's great is the perks. That can really change up your game. So if you invest heavily into gunplay skills, you actually can activate effects for shooting enemies in their limbs when using that TTD, the Tactical Time Dilation. You also have companions who have bonus abilities, but those again only work if you pay enough into the leadership system, and while the level to start using these skills are a bit low, you're going to have to become a jack of all skills, master of none, if you want most of these abilities, and I think you do. Now the dialogue skills that I favored are probably the least important in the game, but the most interesting to select. I honestly think it's almost like an additional hard mode in the game to go with mostly dialogue and stealth. And this is something I found out after researching quite a bit, which I do on these games after finishing, so it was a bit too late for me to find out. Of course, your weapons in the game will also matter, and early on you don't have many choices, but in the early game the enemies will sometimes get like heavy armor, and this becomes a major struggle against those early weapons. It creates a variable combat that is kind of uneven for a good while. I think there's a special place in hell though for the person who decided to throw so many robotic enemies with their heavy armor plating at the player so early. The game tells you to use electric weapons, which I didn't have at the time, of course, and maybe there is some way to get those weapons somewhere, but this is just like the frustrating opening hour of the game. Eventually, though, you will, of course, find good armor, good guns, and when you do find a plasma weapon, the combat changes from challenging at times to mundane. Even those robots that cause so many problems, and yes, I do know where their weak points are, you know, can't stand against your plasma weapons, and you start mowing down enemies all over the place. It becomes routine, and that's a bit of a shame. The loot in Outer Worlds also doesn't help much with this. You mostly will find weapons, and there's just tons of drugs and stat items, but unless you play at higher difficulties, you're probably not going to need them that much, though they will give you a nice boost if you do. Eventually, though, the loot will change and you start earning like the tier 2 weapons, which just jacks your damage up even higher, and from there it's just a game of finding the highest DPS and using those guns. This does happen late in the game, but it's still not very exciting to loot so many of the same guns. Even earning the second tier of them doesn't change enough. You'll mostly be looting huge areas in the game, and you'll end up picking up everything hoping you're going to have a use for it. The same will be true for stealing. You do have some things marked as owned, so you'll be stealing those, but there's not really a penalty I've found for theft. If someone sees you, they might fight you, but you can usually pay them off or intimidate them without a challenge. In fact, there's an entire reputation system that just doesn't seem to play a big part of the game. Stealth in Outer Worlds is also a bit lackluster, especially if you're used to Elder Scrolls and their stealth system. You walk into secure areas that are clearly marked, and if you have the right ID card, which will put a disguise on you, you can pretty much just walk where you want. If you run out of stealth juice, I don't even know what the game calls it, enemies will approach you on sight, but then they'll only give you a couple easy dialogue checks that you can choose any of them, and you can talk your way out of it. You can even do this 3 times in the game, but the checks are so easy and the areas are so small, you really won't be challenged by them. As long as you find the ID cards, that is, which tend to be located right outside of most of these stealth areas. Now, if you are a fan of stealth, though, you're probably not going to like this. It's just too simplistic for anyone accustomed to any level of stealth in almost any game. There's also a setup with flaws here, which offers perk points in exchange for some negatives. I don't want to go too deep with Outer Worlds, and I have covered many of the skills here already, but I can honestly say the perk system, as shown on screen, is a bit underwhelming. You know, in Fallout, there's always at least a couple of series of perks that I want to just buy the whole line of. Here, I waited to like level 6 to start buying perks. There just wasn't anything that I felt strong about, and thus I didn't buy into the flaw system because I didn't need to take a negative just to get one more perk point. It's an interesting idea, but it's not really worth the investment. I would have actually preferred different abilities that you can only get through the flaw system. Now, that's true about several systems in Outer Worlds, though, and it's a shame. You know, I had a thought as I wrote the script for this video. There's a lot of interesting stuff that happens, but the biggest and most interesting moments in the game all happen in like the first hour. Edgewater is a rather interesting and pretty solid area of the game. It's well written, it's fresh, and it looks great. But if someone was to remove Edgewater from this game, they'd be removing one of the best parts of Outer Worlds. I think so much effort went into making Edgewater an amazing opening that they forgot to make the rest of the game live up to that. The best moral choices are in Edgewater, the best characters are there, the rest of the game seems almost rushed or lacking what Edgewater sets up for the entire game, and it's a shame because it means Outer Worlds is strongest in the first hour of gameplay. At the same time, I'm sure my comparisons to Fallout have rankled some fans. I know Obsidian has said they don't have the massive budget for this game, and they're a small indie developer now, and they want to be viewed as one. You know, that's a great story. Let's ignore the size and scope of Take-Two, the parent company. The guys who make 2K Sports, Grand Theft Auto, and Red Dead Redemption, they have the money for this. And this is fine. The issue I have with the "we're a small studio" claim is that even if they don't have the budget for it, they end up still charging $60 like all AAA games. You know, when Hellblade came out and Ninja Theory wanted to be considered a AA game, they ended up charging $40 for it. But here, if they don't want to be compared to the big titles, they need to charge less to be seen as something different. And just to be clear, the price of Outer Worlds is fine. $60 is what people pay for the games, and people will definitely pay $60 for this, but you can't play the "we're a small scale game" and still charge the same price as everyone else. Now, some people will directly compare this game to Fallout 76 and Fallout 4, and those comparisons are valid. It's a much better game than Fallout 76, at least from what I've seen. I haven't played it yet, and I probably never will, and I think it is much better than Fallout 4, at least in a couple ways. As much as I want to say I enjoyed Boston in Fallout 4, it wasn't as great as it could have been. But the thing is, people tend to tout Outer Worlds as some great games because it beats 2 arguably weak games. Just because there's not many amazing contenders to the crown, you don't just crown the first choice. Outer Worlds might be the best Fallout-esque game of the moment, but it has issues, and it's not a perfect experience. It's lacking a lot of polish that fans probably should expect, the story isn't at the levels that Obsidian is worthy of, especially with the Fallout New Vegas brand, and the experience just isn't that amazing. You know, if you like Fallout New Vegas, I think you should go play that again. Then if you want more of that type of game, feel free to play Outer Worlds. And feel free to tell me if Outer Worlds is anywhere near as good as Fallout New Vegas. In my opinion, it's really not. I give Outer Worlds a 3.5 out of 5. To me, that's not a bad score, but it's not an amazing one either. And I think that's where Outer Worlds lies. It is a very solid game, and I hope we see a more polished sequel or a new game from Obsidian. I ended up finishing the game around 15 hours or so. I know there's a lot of variety in time spent in the game from different publications, but I've heard some reviewers claiming like 40 hours of content. That's possible for multiple playthroughs or maybe absolute completionists who do everything in the game, but really this game's going to take you under 20 hours for most people. And that is Outer Worlds. Now, I did play this game on Epic Games Launcher. I have at least two more games that I have on Epic Games Launcher, and I might just talk a little bit more about the launcher when I finish that, but I also am still playing games on Steam, so you can guess my opinion on that. Thank you, however, for watching this. I hope you've enjoyed the video. If you did, make sure you subscribe and click that bell to be notified when I post something new. Feel free to share the video. It helps grow the channel, and I'd appreciate that, of course. I honestly don't have videos to show you here. Nothing I've reviewed really clicks with this, so I'm going to go with Dealer's Choice and see what YouTube decides to show you. Until next time, I'm King Link, and thanks for watching.